गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। बोलिए। ओके, सो सेवन ऑफ यू आर देयर, कैन यू हियर मी? एम आई ऑडिबल? ओके, सो आई स्टार्ट विद द सेशन। सो लास्ट क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द So there are other offences also, property offences. So before starting with today's sections, I want to rectify one point which we have discussed in the last class regarding section 377. So 377 is now, it is not totally decriminalized. It's only partially decriminalized, because the other day maybe Sri Devi, she was asking the question, if a person is having any means against animal, if he commits that particular offense. So this section 377, it's not totally decriminalized, it is only partially decriminalized, only to the extent of homosexuals. So homosexuality is not an offense under 377, but the rest of the acts which have been mentioned under 377, still they are offenses under 377. Please note this point, because the other day in the last session she was asking that person, and I was of the opinion that it has been totally declared unconstitutional, but no, it has not been declared totally unconstitutional, only to the extent of homosexuals, that is LGBT community. They are again recognized again as a third gender, and even they are having rights. For that reason, they have decriminalized only to that extent, not to the other acts. Please note this point. So, hope you have gone through the sections which we have discussed in the last section, and hope it's clear, theft is clear for you. And there are, up to 379 punishment for theft we have discussed. And depending upon the place where they have committed theft, there are three more sections under theft, 380, 381 and 382. So, theft in a dwelling house, and theft by clerk or servant, and theft of the preparation, preparation made for causing death and hurt. These three sections are there. So dwelling house, all of you know, any place where there are some people, they live, it is a dwelling house. So it is very wider concept, because not only a house, pakka with a slab and doors and windows, it's a dwelling house. It may be even a thatched house, it may be a tent or a vessel, all this come under a dwelling house. The important point here is people are using that for their living, that is dwelling house. So if this theft, offense of theft is committed in a dwelling house, here the punishment is imprisonment for 7 years and fine. Why punishment is more in this particular section is nothing but when we stay in a house, we are of the opinion that we are more secure. So, for this reason, if this offense of theft is committed in that secured place, comparatively the punishment is more than under 379. In general, theft is 379, and here specifically, if it is in a dwelling house, it is punishable under 380. Imprisonment for 7 years means maximum punishment is 7 years and fine. Here, Prashant is asking a doubt. Madam, what is difference in dwelling house and harbour or comparison? Harbour, in IPC, harbour means giving shelter. Are you referring to the term harbour in IPC or a seashore? I need clarity from you, Prashant. Because harbour in IPC means, if you go through the definitions, 52A harbour means giving shelter to a person who committed an offence. So do you mean that harbour or harbour of a seashore? Yeah, comparison of harbour in IPC. Harbour means giving shelter. Here giving shelter means giving shelter to a person who has committed an offence. So means they are helping in one sense, we can say that they are helping him so that the police, they cannot take hold of, means they cannot take him into custody. this person who is giving him shelter, he may not participate in that particular offense, but he also will be liable but for giving him shelter. Clear, Prashant? And dwelling house is nothing but people where they reside, where they live. Sometimes nomads, you know, nomads, they'll be living in tents. Where nomads means there is no, I mean, a specific particular place of means to stay for them. There's some, for some days they'll be staying in one place and they'll be moving from one place to another. But for that particular days where they're living in a place, they'll be living in a tent. Even that tent, because they are living in that particular tent, it is known as a dwelling house. It means for the purpose of definition under IPC, meaning under IPC, it is a living place. Clear? So, and next section is theft by clerk or servant of property in possession of master. Why they have specifically given, means already we have discussed under the 378, 379 punishment for theft and all, and dwelling house 380. And here again, specifically they are saying that theft by clerk or servant. Why they have given one specific section for this theft by servant or clerk? Is there any reason for that? Yes. Because when a person employs a clerk or a servant, here, if this offense of theft is committed by him, means here he is believing him, this person who is employing him, he is believing him. He is having trust in him. And he is an employee with that particular person. So here, the punishment will be again more compared to 379. Whoever being a clerk or servant or being employed in the capacity of a clerk or servant commits theft in respect of any property in the possession of his master or employer shall be punished with imprisonment. Maximum is 7 years. Yes, Kausar, you are right, because he resides with us and trust on him. So here, even because there is a trust on him, even it comes under one more section is there, criminal breach of trust. If he is entrusted with property, here again the difference is, if he is entrusted with the property, means the property has been handed over to that particular servant or clerk, then it amounts to criminal breach of trust. Otherwise, it comes under theft. If the property is not entrusted, if it is not handed over to the clerk or servant, then it comes under theft. So often there will be a confusion between theft and criminal breach of trust. Means when this offense is committed by a clerk or servant. So here, one main difference between this theft and criminal breach of trust is, in theft, property is not entrusted, but just he has been employed. Whereas in the criminal breach of trust, the person who is the owner or the possessor of a particular property, he entrusts the property, hands over the property to the particular servant or clerk. And even though the punishment is 7 years, again, this is a cognizable offense, but it is a compoundable offense, and the owner of this, but with the consent of the owner of this particular property. And 382, theft after preparation made for causing death, hurt, or restraint in the order of committing theft. So here the intention is to commit theft, and the person who intends to commit that particular theft means by hook or crook that day he wants to complete that particular offense. He wants to steal some property. So, in furtherance of this particular intention, he is making some preparation. Means he is taking some weapon or a stick or a rope or a knife with him. What is the intention behind taking this particular stick or a knife with him is, if anyone comes in between while committing theft, or while taking away the thefted property, while attempting to commit theft, he want to injure that particular person, or even he want to go to the extent of causing death to that particular person. So here, intention to commit theft, and while going to commit theft, he is going with a preparation. He is taking some arms with him. Why? Because at any cost, he want to steal the property. Even by causing death, or by causing some injury to the to any person who comes in between, who stops him, who prevents him from committing theft, or who stops him while taking away the thefted property. See, remember here, he has taken some arms with him. He went with some preparation, but he did not use that means here. But just with the preparation, he went there to commit theft. That is the gist of Section 382. So, theft after preparation, made for causing death, or restraint in order to the committing of the theft. Clear? And here the punishment is rigorous imprisonment for 10 years and fine. So comparatively, this is a again severe offense compared to the previous sections. Though so the punishment here is rigorous imprisonment for 10 years and more. If it's clear, we'll go to the next section, extortion, 383. Okay, so extortion. In extortion, again, intention will be there. Here also, this is a property offense here. Intention will be there. Intention here to take away some property. And here, property may be either movable or immovable property. In the last class, I told you, theft can be committed only with respect of movable property. Are you hearing? Am I audible? Only with respect of movable property. But extortion can be committed with respect to both movable or immovable property. Here, immovable property includes any valuable security. So here, valuable security may be, it may be a stamp paper, it may be a check. So first ingredient is intention. Second ingredient is with respect to both movable or immovable property. And how he is taking the property? By putting a person in fear of injury. Either here putting that person in fear of injury, or some other person in whom he is interested in fear of injury. Already in the last class also I told you, putting some person in fear of injury means in person in whom he is interested. He may be a relative, a family member of that particular person. So he is taking property by putting a person or any other person in whom he is interested in fear of injury. And so what are the ingredients of theft here? Intention. Intentionally taking away property. Property may be either movable or immovable. And the means how he is taking the property is putting a person in fear of injury. So this is extortion. And one more important point here is, the person so put in fear, he himself, he will deliver the property. See here, in theft, without the consent of the person taking away property, if you remember theft, which we have discussed in the last class. Taking away movable property without the consent of the person is theft. But here, the person, the owner of the property, he himself, he is delivering the property. Make this, means you have to clearly remember this point. He himself, he is delivering the property. So here, can you say that there is consent in this particular offense? I'm expecting answer from you. Is there consent here? Because he is delivering the property. In theft without consent, specifically they have given without consent. In this section they have given that the person, he himself delivers the property. Is there a means willingly is he giving the property? Yes or no? Is there consent or not? Any one of you? So Padma, she's saying that consent by influence, and Sridevi, she and Madhumati, they are saying that there is no consent. Here, Yeah, Kausar. No consent, only fear. Yes, you're right. Here, the consent is obtained by putting that person in fear of injury. And such consent is not a valid consent. Always remember, consent given, section 90, like I say again, consent and fear, misconception, misrepresentation, it's not a valid consent. So here also, consent and fear, it's not a valid consent. Though the person, he is delivering the property. Hope it's clear, extortion. So the main difference between theft and extortion here is, theft is with respect to movable property. Extortion is with respect to movable or immovable property. And in theft, the person means here, it is not, the person is not put in fear. And here, without that person, owner noticing, he will take away the property. But in extortion, the person here puts the owner of the property in fear and the fear of injury and takes the property. And the person who is the owner or having the custody of the particular property, he himself delivers the property because he is under fear. Fear of injury to himself or to some other person in whom he is interested. And one more point here, what you have to remember here is, the person who is extorting that particular property, it is not necessary that he must be in the presence of the person put in fear. Here, he can extort property by calling him on phone or any other, by sending some person to him. Whatever may be, it is not always necessary that he must be before the person so put in fear. Why I am stressing on this point is, later when we are discussing robbery, again, you have to understand the difference. So I am stressing on this point. It is not necessary that the person who is creating that fear must be in the presence of the person put in fear. Hope it's clear. Extortion. And remember, though, term blackmail, very often you will be hearing that word blackmail. Here, extortion is nothing but, here extortion also, they're taking money by putting him in fear of injury. So extortion is nothing but, blackmail is nothing but extortion. And here, even they can extort money. Here, injury, remember, in many classes I told you, injury means, in IPC, it includes both physical or mental injury. They can even extort money by putting that person in fear of defamation. Defamation is, again, injury to the reputation. So injury includes both physical or mental injury. Even you know that there are many cases of blackmail, extorting money from person by putting them in fear of injury to him or to some other person, his son, daughter, or some other relative, or saying that they can make a defamatory statement. And they are extorting money. And there is a question from Nasim. If a person A is extorting B indirectly through a strongman C, and B files a case on A, who should prove the relation between A and C? So here, just now I told you, the person extorting the money, he need not be in the presence of the person. He can extort money by threatening him on phone or by sending some other person. The same means the question you are asking me, doubt you are asking me. So if A sends C to B and extorts money, here B, while he is filing a case, he will include even C's name in that particular FIR. His name will be included. So here, A and C, both of them, they will be liable. And C, because he is aiding him in this particular offense, he will be given the same punishment as given to A. B has to prove that C, on behalf of A, C has come to him and he has extorted money and he has taken money. So, punishment for extortion. Here, punishment for extortion under 384, imprisonment for 3 years, or fine or both, and it's a cognizable non-bailable offense. And next, 385, putting person in fear of injury in order to commit extortion. What is the difference between 383 and 385? There also putting person in fear of injury. Here also putting person in fear of injury. The only difference is, if you go through the wordings of this particular section clearly, whoever in order to the committing of extortion means here it is an attempt. If you are having your books with you, just note down in that particular section, attempt to commit extortion, so that later when you read, it will not be, means you will not find it difficult. You may feel that 383 and 385 are same, but the difference is here it is attempted to commit extortion. There, offense is completed in 383, whereas in 385, it is an attempt to commit extortion. See, clearly, in order to the committing of extortion, puts any person in fear or attempts to put any person in fear of any injury. In order to the committing of extortion, please underline that phrase, in order to the committing of extortion. So here, he want to commit extortion, attempt to commit extortion, and in that process, he is putting a person in fear of injury, or attempts to put a person in fear of injury. Means, offense has not been completed, but as you know, even attempt to commit an offense is punishable. Please recollect the stages of a crime. There are four stages in a crime: intention, preparation, attempt, and commission. The third and fourth stages, that is attempt and commission, they are punishable in all the offenses. Okay, I have given a detailed notes on that for you. And if you are having any doubt, please go through that. So attempt is also punishable. So what is the punishment here? Imprisonment for 2 years, or fine, or both. And even though the punishment is below 2 years, it is only 2 years, maximum 2 years, it is a cognizable offense. Cognizable as well as non-compoundable offense. Next, 386. Extortion by putting a person in fear of death or grievous hurt. So, under 383, it may be any type of fear. It may be fear of, means it may be an injury to a reputation. Means they are falling short of death or grievous hurt, remember. So here, if a person extorts money by putting any person in fear of death or grievous hurt, to that person or to any other person. Here, any other person means any other person in whom he is interested. So, going through the wordings of this particular section, whoever commits extortion by putting any person in fear of death or of grievous hurt to that person or any other person shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 10 years and shall also be liable to fine. So the maximum punishment is 10 years, and even fine shall be imposed. So, difference between 383 and 386 is that any injury other than death or grievous hurt. Here, this person who is threatening him, he is threatening him to cause, means kill him, or cause death to any other person in whom he is interested. That is the main difference between 383 and 386. Obviously, when it is a grievous, comparatively it is more severe offense, punishment will be more. Here, punishment is maximum 10 years. And 387. See, this section again, putting person in fear of death or grievous hurt in order to commit extortion. Can anyone of you tell me the difference between 386 and 387? By this time, you might have understood what is the difference between 386 and 387. Because similarly, means previously I have explained you some other section also. Difference between 386 and 387. 386 is extortion by putting a person in fear of death or grievous hurt. 387 is putting person in fear of death or of grievous hurt in order to commit extortion. What is the difference? If you answer me, yes, you're right, Padma. 386 is extortion completed and 387 is an attempt. Why I'm posing a question is nothing but I want to just understand whether you're following me or not. That is the reason I'm asking you question. Yes, sir. Well, 386 is act committed and 387 is intention to extort. Intention to extort, we can say it is an attempt to extort. Intention will be there in both. It is an attempt to extort. Malavdani, sir. So 386 is act committed and 387 is attempt to extort. As I told you in 383 and 385, 383 is act completed and 385 is an attempt. Here also again 386 is act completed, commission of the offense, and 387 is attempt to commit extortion by putting a person in fear of death or grievous hurt. All other ingredients are same. He is having intention to extort, and how he is creating a fear in a person, how he is creating fear in that particular person by putting that person in fear of death or grievous hurt, by putting that person or any other person in fear of death or grievous hurt. But the only difference is in 386, the act is completed, means the offense is completed, whereas in 387, the offense is not completed, just it is an attempt. That is the main difference. And here the punishment is imprisonment for 7 years and fine. It's a cognizable, non-available offense and it is non-compoundable offense. And 388, extortion by threat of accusation of an offense, punishable with death or imprisonment for life. Here, see the means how he is creating fear. Extortion is nothing but by putting a person in fear of injury. Different means we have discussed. By creating fear means by creating fear by saying that he will defame him, or he will cause hurt to him, or he will cause death to him, or he will cause grievous hurt to him or any other person. This act may be committed in respect of that person or any other person. And in this particular section, how he is creating fear means he is saying that I will implicate you in a false accusation, false charges, so that you will be punished with death or imprisonment for life. Means he is creating fear that I'll create false evidence, fabricate false evidence. Here along with this section, again some other sections also can be charged, that is fabricating false evidence. All this, or giving false evidence, we have not completed because that particular chapter, it's there in your fifth unit. We'll discuss later fabricating false evidence and giving false evidence, 190, 191 and all. But here, how he is creating fear? The accused person or the offender, how he is creating fear? He is creating fear by saying that I will create false evidence and implicate you in false charges, and these charges are such that if they are proved, this person will be sentenced to death. He will be given capital punishment or life imprisonment. So I'll give you a simple example. He'll create false evidence in such a way that he committed murder. Means here the offender creates false evidence in such a way that this victim, we can call him victim, the person who is being extorted, he's a victim, right? So he'll create false charges in such a way that this victim committed murder. And what is the punishment for murder? All of you know under section 302, highest punishment, maximum punishment is death and or imprisonment for life. So here he is creating Madhumati, let me complete this, I'll clarify your doubt. And he is creating a fear and extorting property. So the person so put in fear, he is afraid because he may be implicated in false charges and he may be punished with death or imprisonment for life. And out of that fear, he is giving him property. He is delivering him property. Here property means it may be either movable or immovable property. So, just I'm going through the wordings of this particular section. Whoever commits extortion means offense is completed. Offense of extortion is completed. How he has completed this offense of extortion? By putting any person in fear of accusation against that person or any other. See here again, on that person or any other person in whom he is interested of having committed or attempted to commit any offense punishable with death or with imprisonment for life or with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 10 years. See, what is the accusation? How he is threatening him? That he will make an accusation that he committed an offense, that the victim committed an offense or attempted to commit an offense punishable with death or life or up to 10 years. Or of having attempted to induce any other person to commit such offense. So here, or having attempted to induce any other person. So here, this person have induced some other person to commit such offense. And this punishment for, see, there is some more in this particular section, shall be punished with the imprisonment of any other, of either description for a term which may extend to 10 years. Maximum punishment for this accused person is 10 years under this particular section and shall also be liable to fine along with fine. And if the offense be one punishable under section 377 of this code, may be punished with imprisonment for life. And here, if the offense is punishable under 377 unnatural offense, then the punishment to this particular person, accused person, is imprisonment for life. Hope you understood. And there is a doubt from Madhumati. Ma'am, 385 and 387 also looks similar. Yes, they look similar. But the only difference is 385 is attempt to commit extortion. Means that is a continuation of 383. Comparatively, it is a lesser offense than 387. Why I am saying comparatively lesser offense means under 387, he is attempting to commit extortion by putting that person in fear of death or grievous hurt. Whereas under 385, he is committing extortion. He is attempting to commit extortion, no doubt. But this fear of death or grievous hurt is not there under 385. Hope you understood. That is the reason I told you while explaining 386. Again, this is comparatively is a more severe offense than 383. Because under 383, there is no fear of death or grievous hurt. Whereas under 386, there is fear of death or grievous hurt. Similarly, under 385, there is no fear of death or grievous hurt. There is fear. No doubt there is fear. But some other fear other than short of death or grievous hurt. That is the main difference between 385 and 387. Hope you understood, Madhumati. And all of you also who are online. If you are having any doubt, you can ask me. Even 388 also. 388, is it clear? So here, he is creating fear by putting by saying that he will falsely implicate that particular person in a case. False implication. Impleading him in a false case. That is the gist of 388. Okay, hope it's clear. I'm going to the next section, 389. Putting person in fear of accusation of offense in order to commit extortion. Again, nothing but this is, what is this? What is this section? Any one of you? In order to commit extortion, what is this? Any one of you, what is this? Are you online or just you have switched on your systems and you are in some other work? Because none of you are answering. In order to commit extortion, putting a person in fear of accusation of offense. Attempt to extortion. Nothing but attempt to extortion. So 385, 387 and 389. Please note down 385, 387 and 389 is nothing but attempt. But the way in which they are committing that attempt is different, that's all. In 385, it is comparatively, means causing less fear. In 387, it is fear of death or grievous hurt. And 389, it is fear of accusation. Yes, you're right, Padma. It says accusation, fear of accusation, putting a person in fear of accusation and attempting to commit extortion. Nothing but continuation. 388 is the offense of extortion is completed, whereas in 389 they are attempting to commit extortion by putting a person in fear of accusation. Yes, Rimi, you are right. Trying to commit an offense. Okay, so here 389 is nothing but attempt to commit extortion. All other ingredients are same. Intention is to commit extortion. How he is committing extortion, how he is attempting to commit extortion is nothing but by creating a fear in a person, by saying that I will implead you or in some other person in whom you are interested in false accusation. And if that accusation is proved, you will be sentenced to death or imprisonment for life or imprisonment of 10 years. That is the accusation against him. So here creating again false evidence, including threatening him by saying that he will make a false accusation, and he is trying to commit extortion, attempt to commit extortion. That is the difference between 388 and 390. Hope it's clear. Any doubts in extortion? So if this is clear, we'll be going to the next section, robbery. Okay, robbery. So here, robbery is nothing but either theft or extortion. So, first sentence itself under 390, they'll be giving, in all robbery, there is either theft or extortion. Means, in simple words, aggravated form of theft is robbery, or aggravated form of extortion is robbery. How? What is the aggravated form of theft?
Thank you.
Am I audible now? Now is it audible now? Okay. So, I don't know when the video was lost. Audio was lost. But again, I'll repeat. Simple theft is nothing but without any person noticing, taking away the property. When the doors are open, entering into a house without the inmates' notice, taking away the property. Or when the inmates are fast asleep, whatever may be the means entering into the house. Because again, by opening the doors, windows and all, it comes under housebreaking. We'll discuss that later. So I don't want to confuse you now. So without the inmates noticing, taking away the property. Or without the owner or the person in custody of that particular property, without his notice, taking away the property. It is simple theft. So what is this aggravated form of theft? Because aggravated form, again, it amounts to robbery. So what is this aggravated form of theft? Forcibly taking away property from a person. It amounts to robbery. See, in simple theft, there is no force. And many a times in simple theft, without the person noticing, they'll take away the property. Whereas, in this theft becoming robbery, the person committing robbery, here when theft becomes, otherwise when theft becomes robbery means, the person committing theft, if he uses force, if he forcibly takes away the property from that person, it amounts to robbery. So, the person who wants to steal the property, he'll take away the chain from that particular person. He pulls away the chain. Or he takes away the purse forcibly from that person, not without him noticing. Remember here. So, forcibly, if he takes away that particular property, movable property, remember always, movable property, theft becomes robbery. Hope it's clear. Theft plus force or violence is equal to robbery. Simple equation I'm telling you. Theft plus force or violence is equal to robbery. So, there is a question from Mahbub Hussain. Attempt to cause to any person death or hurt or fear, then also it is robbery. Attempts to cause any person death or hurt or fear, then also it's theft becoming robbery. Coming to extortion becoming robbery, again extortion becoming robbery means the person committing this offense of robbery, he is in the presence of the person. See, I am telling you specifically here, in the presence of the person, the offender, he is in the presence of the person, put in fear, and commits extortion by putting that person in fear of death. Please underline this. In fear of death or instant death. Not death, not even death. Instant death or instant hurt or instant wrongful restraint to that person or to some other person, and by putting him in fear, induces the person so put in fear to deliver the thing extorted. So please follow carefully here. Putting a person in fear of instant death. Putting a person includes here person interested also. Always remember in all these sections, putting a person in fear of death. Instant death. Instant death, not simple death. Instant death means immediately he will kill him. Instant death. or instant grievous hurt or instant wrongful restraint, and the person so put in fear, he himself delivers the property. Whereas in theft becoming robbery, the offender forcibly takes the property. Here, the offender, he will extort the property by putting in fear of instant death or instant grievous hurt or instant wrongful restraint. And the person, here the victim, he himself delivers the property. So in theft, what is the difference again? In theft, the victim, he will not deliver the property. The offender forcibly takes away the property. Whereas in extortion, the victim, he himself delivers the property. And one more point here is, the offender is in the presence of the victim. I told you in 383, while discussing 383, presence of the offender is not necessary in all the cases. Presence of the offender before the victim is not necessary in all the cases. That is what I told you while discussing 383. But here in 390, extortion becoming robbery, the offender is present before the victim and he is creating fear to the victim. And what type of fear here again? Instant death or instant grievous hurt or instant wrongful restraint? Means if he does not deliver the property, instantly he will be killed or some grievous hurt will be caused to him immediately. And because of the fear, he will deliver the property. Clear? Or any doubt? Because these are very simple, but you have to understand clearly the difference between theft, extortion, and when theft becomes robbery, and when extortion becomes robbery. Even in 386, there is, creating fear of death, but not instant death there. And it is not necessary that the offender must be present before the victim there in 386. But here, in 390, extortion becoming robbery, he is present before the person, and fear of instant death, etc. Hope it's clear. And please go through the illustrations. A, B, and all. Clearly they have given when theft becoming robbery under A. And under B, when extortion becomes robbery. All this they have given clearly. Go through the illustrations. Any doubts? Any one of you? So, still there are some more sections. Tomorrow's class will be completing the topic. Even dacoity also is there. So, tomorrow we'll complete that. After this class, please go through the sections once in detail. And if you're having any other doubts, Narsing is asking me, please repeat, maybe when the audio was lost, that I have repeated again, what is simple theft and aggravated theft. So, any other doubts? Any one of you? I don't know the reason, again the attendance is very less, only 15 students they are online, the number is... Initially it was 17, now it came to 15 and again 16. I don't know the reason, maybe you're not having interest or the classes are not effective. If you're having any problem, you can, please, you can inform us, and if you want any other further explanation or any doubts also, feel free to ask us. But I don't know the reason why the strength is very less. Anyhow, any doubts or shall I end the session? Hope you understood the difference between theft, extortion, and robbery. Okay, Narsingh is saying that online classes are useful, but I don't know why the attendance is very less, though it's online class. Okay, no doubts for now. So I'll end this session, and tomorrow we'll meet again. And please, before attending the class, go through the sections which we have completed. Because still it will be fresh in your mind immediately if you go through the sections, and it will be easy for you to understand. Okay, thank you, Padma. She's saying that very effective as far as I'm concerned. And okay, thank you all for attending. Have a nice day.